Love the message of that song, Revive Us Again. I appreciate Brother Doug leading us in that song. We all need to make sure that we pray that we keep that fire in our hearts to see others saved, and this church to grow, the kingdom to grow, that we can take someone to heaven with us one day when this life is over. I ask you to hold your Bibles up this morning if you have them. All right, let's turn them to James chapter 5. James chapter 5. Thank you for bringing your Bible to the house of God. James chapter 5 is where we will look at the text this morning, verses 19 to 20. We welcome you all to the Church of Christ here at Lone Cedar. Thank you for coming our way. I do see visitors again this morning. You are our honor guests. We're so welcome here. We love you. Thank you for coming our way. I just want to thank all of you as this church family for all the outpouring of love that you showed in the last couple of days, especially yesterday in our celebration of life for our sister Margaret Brethren. She was our oldest living member here and been around for 96 years. She's such a sweetheart. We love her and going to miss her greatly. Certainly our hearts go out to Kay and Betty and all the Brethren family in this great loss. But thank you for every act of kindness that you have shown to this family and for the great turnout yesterday, the food and flowers and all that you did. And that's what God's family is all about. We're to weep with those that weep and share in the sorrows, but we also share in joys. And so we just thank you for being a part of the family of God here. So I'll be back tonight at 6 o'clock in worship at that time. James chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. We'll just take these two verses and draw our text this morning. If you're not a Christian, I hope you will open your heart to this message and realize how precious your soul is and how much God loves you. And if you're lost today, that you'll come to salvation this morning. James 5, 19. James writes and he says, "Brethren, if any one of you wanders from the truth, and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins." Very powerful passage. As James comes to the close of his epistle, he stresses to us here the importance of restoring those who have wandered away from the family of God. And folks, restoring those who wander away from God is a responsibility for all of us who are truly children of God. It is a responsibility that is so easy to neglect because we put it off and say, well, somebody else is doing that. And sadly, in most cases, this is often neglected. Well, the purpose of this message this morning is to impress upon our minds, remind us of the importance of engaging in this work of restoring those who have just aimlessly wandered away from God and become unfaithful to Him. I want to encourage us this morning. From the Word of God, educate us on how to carry out this all-important mission of God's people now. Just think in your mind this morning. You think in your mind of someone you know who became a Christian, born into the family of God, saved by the grace of God, and maybe worshiped here with us at one time, or those in this community, or your family, or your friends, or neighbors who once served the Lord faithfully. Because of the old devil who's behind all discouragement, because of maybe a lack of interest in spiritual matters, maybe because of complacency and misplaced priorities, or maybe just some unfortunate circumstances in their life. Whatever the reason or excuse may be, they no longer are walking with the Lord. But Jesus shows us the value in His Word of just one soul who wanders away from the family of God. You know the story, Luke 15, the parable of the 100 sheep, that 99 and that one. It is a parable about a Christian, about a child of God, a member of the Lord's family, who leaves the flock. who leaves that safety of the shepherd and goes out and wanders out in the dangers of the world. But Jesus here in Luke 15 shows us that value of that one lost soul. Of how that shepherd, he leaves those 99 and he goes out into the world and he seeks that one, just that one lost lamb. It may be this morning that you're a wandering lamb in your heart because maybe you're not dedicated to the Lord in your heart as you know you should today. And maybe you become detached from the Lord. Didn't mean to, but maybe the cares of this life, and you find that you no longer pray like you did, or you don't find yourself in devotionals with God daily. If that's the case in your heart, you are possibly one of these wandering lambs that Christ is talking about today. But we see that good shepherd. He loves us. He loves every one of us. And he leaves that 99. And he goes after that one wandering lamb. And he finds it. He brings it back to the safety of the flock. And look at what he says in Luke 15 and verse 6. There's a rejoicing time. He calls his friends together. And he says, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." Look what takes place in heaven. He said, "Likewise, I say to you, there is more joy in heaven over one sinner that repented than over that 99 who need no repentance." Beloved, those today who are no longer faithful to God, maybe they've just slipped through the cracks. Maybe we've just carelessly overlooked someone, but they have a very, very precious soul. And restoring these precious souls who have wandered away, yes, it is ultimately the responsibility of our shepherds here, of our elders, and we the ministers. But it is also the responsibility, according to this text, of all who are children of God. Not only does Jesus deal with this subject in this parable of the 100 sheep, not only does James deal with this subject in our text, but also the Apostle Paul deals with it in Galatians 6 and verse 1. Again, where Paul says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye that are spiritual, you go and you restore that one in a spirit of humility, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted." Again, notice Paul is talking to the family of God. "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault," now that word overtaken comes from the Greek word, which means to take one by surprise. They didn't mean to fall. They weren't like that prodigal son who deliberately and intentionally went out into the world of sin and made their mind up, "I'm going to do this or bust." But this word overtaken implies that one is brought unexpectedly into contact with a strong temptation, and maybe at the spur of the moment, they yield to sin. They're hurting, they're overtaken in a fault. The Bible says now, you who are God's children, you who are spiritual, that is one who's governed by the Spirit of God through the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. It means one who is a member of God's family. Again, not just elders, but he's talking to brethren, to all of us. Ye which are spiritual. He said it is the duty of every one of us as children of the Most High God to act and try to restore or bring back this brother or sister in Christ who has fallen away. That implies that those of the man or the woman needs restored. Apparently they've been damaged by sin. That's what sin does, isn't it? It destroys lives, destroys homes. It destroys the peace in their hearts. And Paul says that effort should be made to repair the damage done to that soul of that individual. And how do we do it? We do it in a spirit of meekness and grace. Not a holier-than-thou attitude like the Pharisees had. Not going as an attitude of pride and acting as holier-than-thou. "Well, I would have never done that. How in the world did you do that?" Like old Peter, who boasted, "Lord, I'll never leave you or forsake you," but he did. Rather, when we go to someone that's been overcome by some problems in their life, since you go with a spirit of compassion and grace and forgiveness, leaving that individual some room to save face. Not the attitude, "Well, I would never let that happen to me," but a spirit of meekness. He says you consider yourself, because none of us are above sin. We all have feet of clay. We never know what effect some incident of surprise might have upon us. It might be us who falls next. Now you may say, "Well, no, it's not going to be me." Peter thought that too. It may be something different from what the person you're talking to is going through, because we all have weaknesses, we all have buttons the devil, again, knows how to push. But he says, listen, when you go to this brother or sister that's fallen, you go with love and compassion and grace in your heart, considering yourself, lest you also might be tempted, and you might be the one to fall. So Jesus dealt with restoring our wayward brothers and sisters. In that parable of lost sheep, James deals with it in our text. The Apostle Paul deals with it here, as we just saw, of how one is overtaken in the fall. And so all of us as God's people are helped in restoring erring brethren. Beloved, I believe the reason sometimes we as God's people do not do a better job of restoring our wayward brothers and sisters is because I really do not believe that we really understand and realize the real danger they're in spiritually. We don't see the danger, but James is very explicit. He's very vivid in telling us the danger of one who has decided to quit God and quit the church and to let the things of this world just overcome them. And to just quit trying. Here again I said, brethren, if any one of you do err from the truth, the one comes and brings you back. Let that person know that that one who takes and retrieves and converts that sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. Look closely at what James has said of that condition of that one who is straying from the truth. When you stray from the truth in this text, you're straying from Jesus. Because Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." So to stray in this text from the truth is really to stray away from Jesus. Now notice the danger therein. Verse 20. They're in danger of death. Not physical death, but spiritual death. Their soul. You'll save a soul from death. That is that second death in Revelation 20:14, which is the lake of fire. One who has wandered from the truth and go back to the world has lost their source of forgiveness. They've cut themselves off from that fountain that is filled with blood that cleanses them, separated from the blood of Christ. In danger of suffering the consequences again of spiritual death. James, or Paul says in Romans 6:23 that the wages, the price to pay for sin is death. That is, spiritual death. So we see that our Lord Jesus and James and the Apostle Paul warns us, listen folks, you better encourage those who quit the Lord. Encourage those who quit church. Encourage those who get so entangled in the ways of this world that they actually just yield to the devil. That's what he wants us to do, just quit. Probably in our minds, just crossed some of our minds at many times, is it really worth fighting the good fight of faith day in and day out, and the struggle when there's so much more fun out in the world? Is it really worth it? Your devil runs that thought through our minds so often. The Apostle Peter gets in on this subject as well. And he depicts a child of God who leaves Jesus, who quits God and quits the church. And Peter goes a step farther and he says, that person who quits God, their latter end is going to be worse with them than their very beginning. Now, what could be worse than never being saved and die lost? Peter says it would be obeying the gospel, having tasted of that heavenly gift, being cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and then to turn your back on Jesus and quit God and quit His church. 2 Peter 2, verse 20, he talks explicitly about that child of God becoming unfaithful to God, and just like old Demas, going back into this world because he loved this present world. 2 Peter 2, verse 20, here it is. For after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're again entangled in the world and overcome, their latter end is worse with them than their beginning. It would be better for them to have never known the way of righteousness. And after they have known it and come to it, to turn away from that holy commandment delivered to them. And here's what God thinks of it. 2 Peter 2:22. But it has happened to them, according to the true proverb, that dog is turned to his own vomit. The side of his watch, the wall of his mouth. Most of you have seen a dog eat a big meal and throw it up and vomit it up, eat grass, try to throw it up, and you won't walk away, you'll just lick that vomit up again. Wouldn't it be sickening to think of eating vomit? But folks, this analogy that the Word of God gives is a sickening thing to God to see a child of His that has been cleaned up with the blood of Jesus and saved by the grace of Him and goes back into the gutter of sin. Such a sad and sickening thing to God to see one turn their back on the blood of His Son. And all the great Christ paid, you'll be that ungrateful and unthankful what Christ did for you. Say, Jesus, thanks, but no thanks. I like the way of sin better. Jesus speaks of this about leaving Him, forsaking His blood, and in talking about that, He talks about degrees of punishment. I want to ask you today, do you believe there are degrees of punishment in hell? Will it be worse on some folks than others in that lake of fire? Will there be levels or compartments in hell, some hotter than others? Listen to Jesus. Luke 12, 47. And that servant which knew his Lord's will, and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. But he who knew not and did not commit things worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. But we live in the Bible Belt, so listen. Whoever much is given, much more shall be required. And to men who have committed much of him, we ask the more. What does this passage say? Jesus is a person who has had ample opportunity. Come to me. How many times have you heard about salvation? What you need to do to be saved? Hundreds of times. A person has had ample opportunity to come to me and obey the gospel and be saved, and yet they reject me. Christ says they'll be beaten with many stripes. In other words, one that lives in Lauderdale County, I believe is what he's saying, who hears the gospel every day, basically. Churches on every corner. Opportunities everywhere. That person rejects the Son of God and dies in that condition. They'll suffer a lot worse punishment in hell than that little person in Africa who has never heard of Jesus one time. Hebrews 10, 26. Hebrew writer speaks of a child of God becoming unfaithful. dying in that condition, having ear to the Lord, and says, for if we sin willfully, there's the prodigal son. He was with the father. He left the church. He left his father. He goes back into the whole pit of sin. If we sin willfully, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remained no more sacrifice for sin. In other words, Christ done all he can do. But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy. Under two or three witnesses, verse 29, Hebrews 10. Of how much sorer punishment, that means worse punishment, shall be thought worthy of they who have trodden underfoot the blood of the Son of God. There it is. Someone who'd be cleaned up with the blood of Jesus and thanks but no thanks. I like the way of sin better. I don't need your blood. They trampled underfoot the blood of the Son of God. They carried that covenant of grace, whereby they were sanctified and made holy, an unholy thing, and has done despite the Spirit of grace. So the Hebrew writer is saying here in chapter 10, yes, it's going to be worse in hell on some than it is on others. Those who received knowledge of the truth, they had ample opportunity, and they walked away from it, and they reject Jesus Christ. He says that one is trampling underfoot the blood of the Son of God. You just think of those old Roman soldiers who nailed Jesus to the cross. What a horrible thing they did. Did you know when one rejects the blood of Jesus, it's just like you're standing at the foot of the cross and the blood running down from Jesus, soaking that ground, and you're walking around under that cross, trampling in that blood, and saying, Jesus, this is what I think of your blood. I don't need you. You're trampling underfoot the blood of the Son of God. You're doing despite to God's grace. That person, he says, will receive a sore or worse punishment. Folks, if these pastors do not teach degrees of punishment, I don't know what does. I'm reminded of Jesus, who those Jewish cities, Bethsaida and Chorazin, Christ says, woe to you, Bethsaida and Chorazin. For if the mighty works had been done in Sodom and Gomorrah that were done in you, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. In other words, they had Jesus right there with them and rejected. He said, I'm telling you what, folks, of Jewish cities, he said, it'll be easier in the day of judgment for Sodom and Gomorrah, as wicked as they were, than for you. Because if Sodom would have had your opportunities, they repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Christ, you were saying to them, hell is going to be heated up a lot hotter for you than for Sodom and Gomorrah, that city of homosexuals and lesbians that was going against nature and burning for lust one for the other. And as fickle as that was, God destroyed them. But on judgment day, those reject the Spirit of grace and had opportunities to come to Jesus and reject it will be easier on Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for one today who rejects the Son of God. He says, for an erring child of God is in this condition. There's no longer any more sacrifice for sin. In other words, Christ has done all he can do. He gave his life. What more can he give? He's coming again, his second coming, but he's not coming to climb back on that cross again and die for you again. He's already done it. Brethren, when we truly understand the spiritual condition of one becomes unfaithful to God. One who detaches themselves from the Lord and his family. It should make us have compassion and bring us to tears to do something to bring them back. Look again at our text. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth and one brings him back, let him know that he which converted that sinner from the error of their way shall save that soul from spiritual death and shall cover a bunch of sins. Shall hide a multitude of sins. Beloved, I know the work of restoring wayward brethren, wayward Christians. It is unpleasant at times, it's hard, but though it has the potential for great joy in this age. In heaven, there'll be more rejoicing over that one than those home. And over 99, that's already said. And also there be rejoicing in our hearts. John, 3 John verse 4 says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. In other words, his converts were staying with the Lord. This week I challenge you. Will you make just one call? Or will you make just one visit? Or you send just one card of encouragement to someone you know who is not where they need to be with the Lord? They need to be brought back. Send them a kind word. Let them know they're loved, they're missed, they're needed. We do notice that they're not here. Let's do our part in loving the Lord and loving our brethren, our brothers and sisters, because we're all going to be together one day in eternity. We that are here this morning as a family of God, we're going to spend forever and forever and forever in eternity, one day together. That's why we must love one another. We all have family, loved ones, close family members that are not Christians. And when they die, it's not so long, it's goodbye, because we'll never see them again. We as God's family, we're the ones who will be together forever and forever. Again, there won't be mothers and daddies and sons and daughters and Smith families and Jones families in eternity. We'll be all God's family. A spiritual family. We're all on our way to this place called eternity. One gets off the road and stumbles and falls. We must do our part to get them back on the right track. Today, if you're not a Christian, come today. Enjoy the greatest blessing in this life. That is now that freedom of guilt of sin in your life and the laid out in another. I don't have to fear going to hell anymore. I don't have to fear not lifting up my eyes and torment anymore. I've got the blood applied to my life. The way you do that is you're baptized into his death. You contact that blood. You bear the old person's sin. Contact the blood. Raised that new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things passed away. All things are done. Doesn't matter what you've done or haven't done. The blood of Jesus is powerful. It'll wash you away. If you need to come home, if you need to have that fire in your heart again, you need reviving this morning to see the urgency. Take someone to heaven with you. Come today. Wipe your slate clean. Together we stand. Close.